Okay, in this video, we're going to be talking about the wrist and the golf swing, specifically what the wrists are going to be doing in setup, takeaway, backswing, and so on. For those of you that might be new to the channel, first-time visitors just stumbled in upon this video, I'm Herman Williams. You can visit, learn more about me at hermanwilliamsgolf.com. You get information there about online lessons, private lessons. But 10 years ago, I started a little three-video series that started the channel, and it started with a grip video. Then it went into a video talking about the importance of a flat wrist at the top of the backswing. And not that that's the only position that the wrist could be in to make a good golf swing, but I just promoted how a certain grip style fit with that kind of wrist style, and then how you would release the golf club. And we're just going back here 10 years later and essentially refreshing those videos and going through some of the positions and maybe how some modern changes have come into what the tour is doing that make that maybe a little different, or at least maybe you could find advantages to doing it a little bit different way. So assuming that you've seen the grip video, or if you haven't, you can run and go check that out. My personal preference with grip, and it's changed a little bit over the years, certainly 30 years ago I had a weaker grip than the one that I'm using now, and my wrist action was a little bit differently. But the grip that I have now I would describe as a strong left-hand grip, but not excessive, but I'd say it fits in with how the tour is trending right now. As you would look down at the left hand, you know, there's a definite noticeable break across the back of the wrist, heel pad noticeably on top of the club, the thumb is off center over as a right-handed player to the right side of the shaft, and definitely the third knuckle is in view. But the right hand very neutral, palm facing the target, trigger finger here is noticeable. And even the grip video I have that's from 10 years back probably actually goes into more detail exactly how to hold it than the one that I've just done here recently. But you can look back at all of that. But let's get into what the wrist's doing. And even in the title of the video, a term that I kind of stay away from is wrist cock. I think people hear the term wrist cock and they get this idea that we're going to be vertically moving the wrists. We kind of, in layman's terms, we talk about this little dished out joint right here behind the thumb. It's kind of a hollow spot that I think they just, in layman's terms, call a snuff box. And most people are going to think that the move you're going to make is to hinge that up and down and get a real feeling of vertical break like this, going into a backswing and getting that break. The problem, I think, with concentrating on that feel too much, or that language, or however you want to describe it, is that it's going to tend to increase the range of movement at the wrist. It's going to tend to take that lead wrist and cup it some additional amount and start to open the club face. And it's very comfortable. That's one of the problems with the golf swing. Most of the things that feel good don't work so well, or at least what feels really natural and easy to our anatomy. So let's get into the details about how this should move. So assuming we've got that grip established, as you look at my setup face on here, what you'd notice, I don't put forward press into the club. I don't like that. I think it's harder to aim the golf club when it's that way. I use the shaft like a T-square, just 90 degrees out from the body. And you're gonna notice there is definite cupping, or that dish shape, in the lead wrist. Now, as we move into takeaway, you've got choices here, and I've got a video from a few years back about takeaway that's pretty detailed on this, but you know, kind of that traditional one-piece look is really driven with the chest and upper body, not much wrist action here. But you could choose to begin to use the wrist. But if you do, the motion that I want you to feel is taking out that cupped shape. It's moving from that broken feel to the flat left wrist, as the trail wrist, in my case, the right wrist, is going to be bending back. If you choose to just go with that real one-piece look where there's no hand action, that's fine. But you're still going to get that wrist break movement somewhere later into the motion, maybe up here around waist high. And again, the idea here is we have done no rolling, we've done no vertical hinging at this point. And a lot of people say, well, Herman, you know, what about the guys that do an early set? Well, you know, in my opinion, the early set that you want is this way, not this vertical version that you see like this. Now, you can see successful players do anything. I mean, particularly tour players, they're incredible at recovering from certain movements that they put in. And sometimes they'll choose a move like this. You know, Ben Hogan cupped the wrist on purpose to open the face up. because he had such a hard time hooking it as a younger player. So you may see them make a motion to offset a behavior that they've had in their past that would wreck your game. So be careful when you look for little nuances like that that you see from some of your favorite players out on tour. But starting back at the beginning, we've got that dish shape in the wrist. We can get rid of it early, kind of an early set. We can get rid of it a little later, further back into the takeaway. But somewhere by about this stage of the swing, we have that trail wrist flattening and that, the lead wrist flattening and the trail wrist bending back, more or less to its full range of movement. So at that point, you can see that I'm not calling that a wrist cock at all. It's a hinge or a backward bend. I mean, some people get into the terms flexion and extension and all that baloney. I don't think we need fancy words. You get the idea that we're here. But now how are we moving to the top of the swing? This is where I'd often see the mistake that the vertical hinge would come right into play. The shaft would move straight up. We'd get maximum hinging at the lead wrist, knuckles buckling back toward the forearm, and really starting to open the face. So the motion that gets us to the top from here is really a very simple pivot kind of around the right elbow position as a right-hander that just begins to move the arm as it's rotating in the shoulder socket back up to this kind of famous description of how you'd hold a waiter's tray at the top of the swing. Now, obviously, once we're in posture, you can't really hold the tray, but it would feel that way if you were standing straight up. But again, you see the maximum bend in the trail wrist. Now, I will grant you that as that's going on, there is a little bit of that wrist cock feel going on in both wrists. But I want you, I'll move up a little closer to the camera. You notice how much movement that is. It's pretty tiny. So I've maintained the flat lead wrist, maintained the bent trail wrist, and the amount of hinge, you can just see it's moving the club a few inches. It is not this wholesale massive break. We see a lot of players start letting go with the fingers of the lead hand to kind of get some extra angle in here and then grab the club to start back down, and it gets terrible. So the big thing here is maybe understanding that the so-called wrist cock or that vertical hinge component is a pretty minor amount of movement in the swing, and the majority may be this kind of a sideways feel that maybe you haven't had quite right. So back through, early set if you want, later set, move to the top. It's going to be a pretty solid structure here in the wrist with a tiny amount of the wrist cock right in the joint. Don't try to expand it. Don't try to lengthen the swing. Don't try to buckle the wrist back. Now, you may have questions about, should you have a flat wrist at the top? Should your wrist be bowed? We see Colin Morikawa. We see Dustin Johnson here. We see probably the bulk of the tours in a flatter wrist. We might see some of the stronger grip guys in a cupped wrist. I'm going to actually cover that next in a separate video. I know you guys don't really watch much more than about 6 minutes of these things, so I'm going to try to avoid a 15-minute deal here. But anyway, hopefully that helps you distinguish the difference between this vertical hinge or wrist cocking kind of a movement versus the movement that the tour players are really doing here and how it would really affect your motion in the swing. The pure vertical motion, just if it's overdone, tends to open the face, and then as the speed builds up, you never get an opportunity to recover. So hopefully that helps you out with that. Look for the next video, kind of talk about some of the positions at the top, and then we'll even talk about the wrist action and transition and downswing after that. If you like the video, be sure to subscribe, like it, tell your friends about it, all that good jazz. Thanks again, Herman Williams for HermanWilliamsGolf.com.